Thank you for the introduction. And I would like to thank the organizers for the invitation. It's a honor to speak at this conference. I learned a lot from Jean-Pierre's works, and well, we met a long time ago, 1990. And well, we were both young and you were famous at that time, so. it will be kind of overview of Monge-Ampère and Hessian equations as a background for open problems. So we shall consider Monge-Ampère equations, which are subset of Hessian equations, and variations of those. And here, well, we maybe in chronological order, the J-flow was the first to study, invented by Chen and Donaldson independently. But solved mostly by work of Winkoff and Song-Winkoff. Then the next thing could be a Fu-Yau equation. So in the dimension 2, this is the Monge-Ampère equation with some extra terms of lower order. But in higher dimensions, it's a Hessian equation with a gradient term. And this more general version was studied by, so dimension 2, it's a Monge-Ampère equation. But in higher dimension, this is Hessian and studied mostly by Fong, Picard, and Zhang. And solving this, you obtain some special solutions of the Strominger system. Then I continue this. Form type Monge-Ampère equations. They were introduced by Fu, Wang, and Wu. But solved mostly in the work of Tosati and Winkoff. And then those two, together with Sekele-Hiddy, finally they solved Godushan conjecture. This is the most general form at the moment of solved equation. Right, then there is also interesting paper by Gabor Sekele-Hiddy where he introduced this C sub solution technique, which is very helpful to solve Hessian equations, but also more general equations. For instance, Hessian quotient equations. And finally, something we've seen on this conference, this special Lagrangian or, as you call it, deformed Hermitian-Young-Mills equations, Collins, and Jacob, and Yao. So I will discuss those. Those are commercials here, as Bu says. But I would like to emphasize that some methods developed here work for some of those, and also backwards. For instance, some estimates of Tosati-Winkoff were later used by to solve Hessian equations on Hermitian manifolds. Also, I will discuss mostly weak solutions, well, those, all those equations are related to geometrical problems. And then if you study a geometrical problem and there is a presence of singularities, then you are often forced to consider weak solutions. And that's why they are also interesting. So let me start with the Monge-Ampère equation in domains in CN. So omega is a, say, strictly pseudo-convex, or you can think about strictly convex set in CN. And we have this equation. This is the Lebesgue measure, or the volume form, or in the more general setting, just a non-negative Borel measure. Then the classical result by Caffarelli, Conier, and Bersprach. Gives a solution to the Dirichlet problem in the smooth non-degenerate case, but F is strictly positive and smooth. Also, boundary data is smooth. Dirichlet problem, well, in this domain. But even earlier, Bedford and Taylor solve the equation for continuous data, and then obtaining weak solutions. And in the subsequent paper, they use this solution to develop what we nowadays call pluripotential theory. Well, what I mean by that is, well, you explore the fact that DDCU is a positive current for any pluripotential harmonic U. And then the first problem you have is to define the wedge products of such currents, and you can do it by Bedford and Taylor for instance, for continuous pluripotential harmonic functions. Then you obtain bigger letters? Okay, yeah, sure. So the basic notions here are capacity, well, the comparison principle, which corresponds to maximum principle for smooth functions, but it's more robust. And then also having capacity, volume capacity estimates. So this volume capacity inequality has the following form that we bound volume of a set by a function of capacity such that, well, f is a function such that f of 0 is 0, but it also tends to 0 very quickly when t approaches 0. For instance, you can take, I guess, f of t equal exponents of minus constant times t to the power minus 1 over n. And this volume capacity estimate is crucial to obtain L infinity estimates in more general setting. So if we assume that F is in LP, P is bigger than 1, then still you can, so you obtain L infinity estimate, out of this you can also get continuous solutions. And nowadays we know that they are also Hölder continuous, under mild assumptions close to the boundary. All right, and just now to go to the first question. A long time ago, I obtained the following statement that for the Dirichlet problem here, if you have a bounded subsolution, then you can find a bounded solution. Now, a recent result by Kuong Ngoc Nguyen says that if you have Hölder continuous subsolution, then you obtain Hölder continuous solution. And now the question is something in between. You would like to have, so this is question one, if a continuous subsolution gives you continuous solution, you can assume that the boundary data is zero and is a ball. OK, so having the question, we can move to Keller manifolds. So now X omega is a Keller manifold, compact Keller. And the Morgan pair has the following form, which we have seen several times here. Now there is, so we require that the form omega plus DDCU is non-negative, and the necessary assumption for F is that if we integrate over X, we get the volume. And the famous Calabi-Yau says that for smooth positive F, you can solve. And well, how it was proved, we have seen yesterday, because Yao himself presented the method. So this is continuity method. With quite delicate a priori estimates. And the last one which was needed there is surprisingly enough L infinity estimate proved by Moser iteration. But you can also try to apply pluripotential theory, and still using pluripotential theory you can get L infinity estimate, and then using Yau solutions you can obtain weak solutions, again, for F in LP. Then you obtain continuous solutions. And again, later, it was proven that they are, in fact, Hölder continuous. And now we come to the exponent of this Hölder exponent for F, if we fix B. So this is a statement by Demailly plus 5 other authors, which says that if, under this assumption, if we take alpha smaller than 2 over n, n is the dimension, maybe I didn't mention this, of course, n is the dimension of x, p star is the conjugate of p plus 1. Then you can find a solution which is Hölder continuous with this exponent, with this Hölder exponent. Now, by essentially by the work of Plisch, it is known that the exponent cannot be better than two over n conjugate of p. So it's not a huge difference, but still the question is about the optimal exponent. And this is even more interesting because this is for Keller manifolds. Then I will come to Hermitian manifolds. For Hermitian manifolds, we don't have such a good estimate. And then so the here the gap is bigger. So the question is even more interesting for Hermitian manifolds. Okay, now let's move to Hessian equation. So using the same form notation, okay, let's start with omega in Cn, which should have some convexity of the boundary. I'm not discussing here the boundary conditions and requirements. So-called M Hessian equation has this form. Where here at the beginning, omega is just a Euclidean volume form in Cn. In terms of eigenvalues of the complex Hessian, so if lambda are eigenvalues of complex Hessian, and if S, say M, denotes the elementary symmetric polynomial of degree M, then the equation can be written in such a way, Sm of f is given. We look for u whose eigenvalues satisfy the equation. But there is, for ellipticity, we need extra conditions. So in this notation, we require a ddcu to the power k wedge omega to the power n minus k, they are all non-negative, for k between 1 and m. OK, again, for smooth positive data, this was the equation was solved by S.Y. Lee in 05. And the method is very similar to the method used by Caffarelli Nirenberg and Sprague to solve real Hessian equations. So following Caffarelli, Nirenberg, Sprague. Again, you can use pluripotential theory, or you can try to use. And in this case, most things go quite easily. The only problem was this volume capacity estimate, which is related to the following question by Błocki. So first, let me state the result. This is Dinev and myself. So if, again, if we have F in LP, but now P is not bigger than 1, but it has to be bigger than N over M, then we obtain continuous solutions. And as I said, to prove this, we need to prove volume capacity estimate. But let's first consider the fundamental solution of the Hessian equation. So you have modulus of z to the power 2 minus 2 n over m. If you solve, then you obtain the Dirac measure. And then you can really compute that g belongs to LQ if and only if q is smaller than m times n over n minus m. And inspired by this, Błocki conjectured that m subharmonic functions, well, what are m subharmonic functions? Those are satisfying the inequality in line three from the bottom. So these are admissible solutions for Hessian equations. So his question was the following: if u is m subharmonic, does it follow that u belongs to LQ, where Q is satisfies this? And with Dinev, we partially solved this. So we proved this under the assumption that if we have u m subharmonic in omega, and if, moreover, u is bounded close to the boundary, then this is true. But still, in the whole generality, this is a question. So I think three, right? But then, as I said, if we assume more, then we have this. And from this, we obtain the appropriate volume capacity estimate from which L infinity estimate for this equation follows. Now we move to compact Keller manifolds, so Hessian equation. So again, as in the case of Monge-Ampère equation, it has a slightly different form. And again, we require that the forms like this are non-negative for k between 1 and m. OK, so the first thing you try is continuity method of Yau. And then L infinity estimates are quite similar, and they were obtained by Hu. Later, by pluripotential methods, we obtained them also. with DNF. But then the major problem was C2 estimate. And trying to solve the equation who, ma, and wu, obtained the following. So we have C2 estimate, so we take DDCU, some kind of norm with respect to omega. But here we have the gradient of u. So if we had a C1 estimate, then we could obtain C2 estimate as well. But then in the proof of Yao, he obtained directly C2 estimates. He didn't need C1 estimates. Here you cannot avoid this somehow at the moment. So we have C2 estimate in terms of C1 estimates. So the problem was this now. And well, also these authors mentioned that you can use it, this kind of estimate, for so-called blowing up analysis. Vaguely speaking, you fix a chart, and for instance, so first you fix a point for which you have the maximum of this gradient. Then you rescale, so the chart blows up to Cn. Then after this rescaling, the Hessian equation, if you start with smooth data, the Hessian equation becomes homogeneous equation. And you get C1 estimate if you can prove the following Liouville theorem or Liouville type. Okay, so if we have a M subharmonic function in Cn, which is bounded, and in our case, we also have to assume that the gradient is bounded, then it is a constant. Well, this statement is enough to apply blowing up analysis here. So with DNF, we succeeded this, and one can solve the Hessian equation for smooth and positive. Of course, F has to be, again, has to be normalized in the same way as in the case of Calabi-Yau theorem. Well, the natural question is if you can prove the real Liouville theorem. The question 4. For M subharmonic functions. This is maybe not so interesting when it comes to solving the equation because it has been solved, but still it's a very natural question. And again, we can obtain weak solutions under the same assumptions. For P now I'd like to remark the following. Namely, in this proof, it's not clear from what is written, but to prove this, we had to use pluripotential theory in a very essential way. So despite you work here with the smooth data, you have to use pluripotential theory. And in fact, the whole proof is a combination of pluripotential and standard elliptic theory. And the second remark, this method, which means Humau estimate plus this Liouville type theorem, proved to be useful in, well, in some of those more general equations. After, of course, after modifications, suitable modifications. Okay. Now, this time I don't say anything about Hölder continuity because, well, it's not proven. The main problem is, again, the regularization. So let me say a few words about this. So for pluripotential harmonic functions, we just, in the flat case, we just use convolution, and we obtain a sequence or family of smooth functions decreasing to the given one, right? Now, if we have some curvature, so if we are in the, say, manifold case, then it's no longer so easy, and this is a deep work by Jean-Pierre. What we can do? On the manifold, we still, okay, instead of convolution with a smooth function, consider a convolution with a characteristic function of a ball. On the manifold, we have charts, so the balls are not uniquely defined, but if you use geodesic balls, they are uniquely defined. And you can try to regularize just taking the average over small balls. Then it's well defined, but doing this, you lose some positivity of the current. So this is exactly what Demay did. He very precisely estimated the loss of positivity. When we regularize, say, convolution-like. So, and this estimate was crucial to prove Hölder continuity for the Monge-Ampère equation, for the solutions of the Monge-Ampère equation. But for Hessian equations, we are lost. We don't have any natural method of approximation. As we already have seen here, there is a method by Berman and then applied in this context of Hessian equations by Lu and Nguyen. Which, well, so the statement is that given a bounded M subharmonic function, say omega M subharmonic function now, omega M subharmonic, which satisfies this, you can find a decreasing sequence of smooth omega M subharmonic functions converging to the given one. But what you have to do in this procedure, you have to solve the Hessian equation, which is not a natural method because you would like to have it in the reverse order, first to have regularization and then apply it, for instance, to solving the equation. So regularization using solutions of Hessian equations. So the question may be number 5. Is there an easy, say, of regularizing omega m subharmonic functions. Okay, and now we change the setting. Now we move to Hermitian manifolds. Those are quite recent results. Namely, if we consider first the Monge-Ampère equation, this looks almost the same, but not exactly, because now F is given. And we look for U and C. Now the volume is not preserved by changing the function here. So the solution means that we find U and we find positive C such that this equation holds. And the first work was done by Charrier. Who solved the equation and in general for positive bisectional holomorphic curvature, so under restrictive assumptions in higher dimension 2. But then finally the equation was solved by Tosati and Wyckoff. So again, they followed the Yau method. The L infinity estimate was more difficult, still the Moser iteration by more involved. There were also some estimates by Guan and Li, C2 estimates given before the final solution. And okay, we can solve. So given smooth positive F, one can find smooth U and a positive constant C such that this holds. Now, so if you follow the Yau method, the problem is that now d omega or dc omega are no longer zero in the Hermitian case. So if you do integration by parts, this kind of terms appear, and you have to estimate them as well. Another thing is that this constant moves together with the function. So you also have to find estimates for the constant, which are independent of the function. From the point of view of pluripotential theory, the main problem is that now the comparison principle which in the Keller case is very simple. Maybe not simple to prove, but the statement is simple. It is no longer true in Hermitian case. And this was the main problem to carry over the pluripotential theory to the Hermitian setting. But finally, with some weaker forms of this comparison principle, we succeeded again to solve the equation for F in LP. So we obtained continuous solutions. It was in, L infinity estimates were given by Dinev and myself. And then the solutions obtained by Nguyen and myself. This is about existence. I didn't speak about uniqueness. We have uniqueness everywhere so far, except in this case. And the more general theorem is about stability. So if we have two functions in LP, P is bigger than 1. But now we assume that, well, at least one of them is strictly positive, so it is bounded away from 0. And so we consider exponent which is between 0 and 1 over n plus 1. And solutions u and v corresponding to f and g. So then we can prove that there exists a constant which depends on many things, well, on geometry and LP norm of f and g, such that this difference is bounded by c times the difference of solutions in LP, 2 power alpha. And the question, and the natural question here is, if this assumption is really needed. I doubt it. I mean, probably if you take just non-negative, maybe some exponent here should be different, but some kind of stability I expect. So is f bigger than 0? Okay. And, well, the same applies to uniqueness, because from this we obtain uniqueness, still under this assumption. In the general case, it's still open. One can also use this stability theorem and the regularization technique based on the my estimates to prove Helder continuity under the same assumptions. But now we have the exponent alpha, which is smaller than 2 over conjugate of p times n plus 1 plus 1. So we are back to question 1. If one can improve, I'm sure one should be able to improve this exponent, but at the moment we cannot. Well, the latest development is that fortunately we can prove Helder continuity without this assumption. So bypassing stability theorem, using the result from the beginning, which I mentioned by Nguyen, with this Helder continuous subsolutions. So using this result, instead of stability, we can now prove the Helder continuity with this exponent without this assumption. All right, I'm not sure I have time for Hessian equations. So just briefly, well, with the Hessian equation, again, you have to incorporate this constant C. And this was just recently proved in the smooth case by Dekai Zhang, and independently by Gabor Sekelehidi. As I said, his method is more general and covers more general equations. And so to prove Calabi-Yau type theorem for Hessian equations on Hermitian manifolds, you have to combine the techniques, as I also mentioned, Tosati-Weinkov estimates for this form type Monge-Ampère equations, plus this technique with Humau and Liouville type theorem. So this was done by Zhang. Well, partially also Sekelehidi used this approach. And again, this is the result of myself and Nguyen. If you take F in LP, P bigger than N over M, and f, well, f cannot be identically zero. I forgot this in the Monge-Ampère equation statement. Yeah, here. It cannot be identically zero also. Then you can find continuous solutions. So here there are more open problems. Because, again, Helder continuity is a question. Stability is a question. Thank you.